Richard Nixon has really grown in his job. That's something you hear a lot nowadays. And I want to tell you how this all started, how he became the figure that's going to the summit, and why he stands a good chance of being the next president, and why he is the president now. That's what it sounds like. No, this is the way it started. I'm going to give you a review of American history here in about 10 minutes, starting last August. Last August, I was in New York, which I hate. I must say that. It's always on, you know. And Vernon Duke wrote a song. I was there in the summer, and I was working in the Copacabana, which is not like this club, precisely. You know, I've been followed. In most of the clubs I worked, I've been followed by a group of people called the Young Comedians, whatever that means. But none of them go there. That's how I lose them. If you ever want to lose anybody in the curves, go there in the Shaperie and the Americana in Miami. That's when, you know, they stop. Usually stay in these places. So I went to Copa. The Copa's not like this. See, we're all kind of middle class, all of us. But the Copa has the other classes in society. The audience is made up of kind of the aristocracy, sort of white-on-white tablecloths. And then in the kitchen, you have the busboys who are all Cubans, you know, wild. Really, so you have labor there, you know, the class struggle. So I was working at the Copa, and I was kind of depressed because it was summer in New York, which is the worst. And, you know, Vernon Duke wrote a song called Autumn in New York, but he obviously had not spent the preceding summer there. The worst. And there's no life. You know, it looks like they're shooting on the beach. It's nothing. You never see anybody. They're all upstairs, you know, with air conditioners, you know, those rabbit hutches they inhabit. And they have those 1695 Motorola air conditioners, you know, with a box, and inside there's a hamster running on a belt. And, what? Batiste. So, so that's the, and then, it, you know, it drips on the sidewalk, and then the, you know, the New Yorkers, very observant, but 8 million New Yorkers got hot at the same time, August 24th, and turned on their air conditioners at the same time, and as a result, the turbines of Consolidated Edison, this utility, they froze, and the New Yorkers could not accept that. I mean, like, they're expedient, you know, they could come out mechanically with candles and flashlights, but they couldn't accept the fact that a public utility failed. They couldn't get it, and see, that's because they were operating in the areas of faith, you know, they were let down. I think an intellectual could think his way out of it. You know, power corrupts. I thought of that. That's a good one, right? Pretty corny, huh? Applying my education for the first time in 8 years. Anyway, so I'm walking around there pretty, and I was walking through Central Park with some delinquents running around there who stopped me, gang of kids with knives. And I stood my ground and told them that I admired their vagabond existence. And I wanted to join them. And they panicked from the responsibility. They really did. Isn't that interesting? They panicked out completely, you know. I was chasing them out of the park. You forgot your knife, right? So, all right. So now, I told you that so you wouldn't freeze, you know. But what else were, oh yeah. So anyhow, then I'm walking around New York and I'm very bugged, and I get a call from the Air Force Reserve, of which I'm a member, saying that we are being mobilized and I'm to report, and they give you a classified address and you have to go there. So I report in, and we're being mobilized. There's a lot of headlines. The Russians say, get out of West Berlin, get out, get out. It's gonna be a war. So I go to the reserve, and I meet my group commander, who's a light colonel, and he is an assistant branch manager of a bank or something. But so he says, well, we're being mobilized, and that. So I said, can I see you in the orderly room? He says, yes. So afterwards, I saw him, and I said, listen, I'd like to know why we're going, you know, because I just want to know the reasons and all. And could you tell me some of the reasons? And that's because if you write them down, you know, the reasons, and you paste them in your helmet, see? And then, you know, when you get shook overseas, your morale gets low, you can always refer to it. And then, no. Why are we going? So he says, well, I want to tell you why. He said, first of all, the people of West Berlin are more than 6 million people. You know, they're really a symbol of freedom to people all over the world, except in Cuba and in Panama and some other areas. But anyway, so I said, okay, and I wrote that down. And he said, and the satellite nations are oppressed. I said, okay, the satellite nations, don't go so fast. They're what? Oppressed? Okay. And then he said, And not only that, but there's anti-Semitism. The communists are anti-Semitic. As you know, the Russian people were anti-Semitic before communism, and the communists, some things they can't, right? They can't ruin. And that thing has gone on its own. Even they aren't big enough for that. So I got that down, and he said, and let me tell you some of their abuses in Siberia. I said, I don't want to hear any more, sir. That's enough. You know, because a man can take so much. I was mad enough to go. So I'm ready to go, you know, because those are enough reasons. Now, aren't they? So I'm ready. Right? And I figured I'd get a good job, you know, starting planes or something. Right? So I haven't been attending at drills. I don't know what happened on the tech orders. Those are the kind of planes we had before. It flies. So I'm going to work 3 nights later, end of August, remember? I'm going to work, and there's a guy standing out there selling papers. He says, read all about it. Richard Nixon is going to Russia. And a couple of people came up and said, to stay? I said, no. The next day, Nixon's going over to fly in. You know, we're almost at war. So he flies out the next day, and he's got the plane with him. He's got Westbrook Pegler's on the plane, who had married recently as a part of a humanization process, as yet unsuccessful. And who else? And he took Admiral Hyman Rick over to show the Russians we have no discrimination. And he took an observation team of industrialists made up of the president of IBM, the president of Inland Steel, and the chairman of the board of the Chase Manhattan Bank, so that the Russians could see what we're really like. Right? Jet City. So they go to Russia, 9 hours, 54 minutes, set down in the Moscow International Airport, and the crowds are somewhat cold, we read. And Nixon went to Gorky Park, the American exhibition, went in the model home, and argued with Khrushchev on TV, remember? And, you know, we're going to the moon, yes, but color television, yes. But we're going to outer space, but you have no shoes, and all that. And people began to see that Nixon was pretty forceful in this new role, and that if he continued to run against the Russians instead of the Democrats, there's no telling how far he could go. So. And he came back, and everybody said, you know, he's been in a new role. And as far as that goes, President Eisenhower was in a new role, having been completely in charge while Nixon was out of the country. Is that correct? Well, Will Rogers. So now he comes back, and he says, we're still, now, this is the first thing I couldn't take was this thaw in the Cold War, because I think we should be forceful with the Reds. It's one language they understand. Then Nixon said, I've invited Khrushchev here so he can find out how we live. I didn't dig that either, see? And he's coming in 2 weeks. So I bugged, and I said to everybody, I don't think that red killer should be here because it's, you know, oppression of the satellite nations and everything, and anti-Semitism in Russia and all these reasons. And he's coming here. So I went to my group commander there, this colonel, and I said, listen, why is he coming here? What about the satellite nations and suppression? And the colonel said, well, he's going to be here in a week. Why don't you see him and ask him? You know, it had all changed. That's when I began to get the message. The week before Khrushchev came, President Eisenhower said, we've got to learn to live with Russia, which I found was kind of a curve. I wasn't ready for that. And then after that, just before Khrushchev came, Israel started trading with Germany. You remember? A Mercedes-Benz made in Israel, right? So I began to feel as a draft in the air. Something's wrong. Right? It's a little rough. Meanwhile, Khrushchev comes here, and I'm at the University of California trying to organize a hunger strike against Khrushchev. That doesn't go too well in this country. We're not too unified that way. It's like we're single-minded. In other words, if President Eisenhower went on a hunger strike over some legislation, I have a feeling that no matter how loyal, most of the Republicans would say, why should I stop eating if he isn't hungry? You know that? That's what I mean. So, he then lands here, Khrushchev, and I was ready for any eventuality, because these were unscrupulous people. One of the visions I had is that he might land at the airport alone. See, now think of the propaganda value here of this TU-114, the biggest turboprop in life, coming in, and this little man getting out alone, you know, with goggles and a cap. Right? And then all the Marines at the airport and the honor guard would say, our leaders can't fly. Right? Which is not altogether true. Some of our leaders can fly. Arthur Godfrey. So, But he didn't. He behaved himself, and he'd never been in a democracy before, this killer. So when he got off the plane, hope you'll pardon my bias, but I feel very strongly about these things. He got off the plane, and Eisenhower said, "We're glad you're here," which was kind of nebulous because this is democracy. He was surrounded by constituents with signs saying, "What have you done with my brother?" Hungary. Remember? Now we're in September. And he rode into Washington, and everybody was apathetic. Nobody tried to shoot him or anything. Right? And then he went to Garst's farm in Iowa, and he met Adlai Stevenson again, and Khrushchev said to Stevenson, "If you want to be president, I want to tell you how to seize power." And Stevenson admonished him and said to him, "That's not the way we do things in this country." But several members of the Democratic Advisory Council who were present admonished Stevenson to keep quiet and listen to this man. Right? All right, now. Then he went to California, and he was taken to 20th Century Fox Studios. Now, you can imagine, how does this sit? Here, good Americans can't get into that studio on a tour. And here's this dictator walking around the studio. And he introduced him to Frank Sinatra, and he had never heard of Sinatra, Khrushchev, proving my contention that Khrushchev is impossible to deal with. Glad you agree with that. Then what happened? Oh, yeah. Then he met Norris Polson, the head of a diplomatic service down south. Remember that? And Polson took him through the miracle mile. Our stores are open till 9. Good Lord. So, or whatever he says. He doesn't say that, as you know. So, I just didn't want you to get annoyed on two levels. So then he left Khrushchev and he said, "I want Eisenhower to come to Russia. You dig? Things are changing." And Eisenhower said, "I'll go," which bugged me even more. Then the president said, "We should disarm." Now we're getting on toward Christmas. I was really getting hacked. Then after Christmas, Nixon said, "We have to recognize Red China because there's 650 million people there that they know about, which really bugged me. And it became apparent to me that if you maintain a consistent political position, you'll eventually be tried for treason. Thank you. Then Eisenhower took off. He started that soap opera, "Don't mail a letter, I'll be there on Wednesday." He's flying everywhere. So he's got a Secretary of State no one ever talks to named Christian Herder, and who is on Malta waiting for a care package or something, So he never talks to him. Then he went, remember he didn't even want to appoint him. That was like a year ago, and he appointed him there's no enthusiasm. You remember? The president said, "Well, it's an arduous job." That was the evasive tactic. And, "Hey, you should take a physical exam." "How about a written exam?" Then he went to Germany, Eisenhower, and 160,000 people are at the Bonn airport. So the Hearst paper said he was received as no one ever has been in Germany before. Although, if memory serves us correctly, wasn't Eisenhower in Germany before? Yeah, I thought so. I was with him too then. We weren't received that well, were we? They didn't know you were coming, right? Then he went to Pakistan. And he was asleep, the president, when the press conference was held. And Jim Haggerty held the press conference, his right foot. And he was asked when the president's going to Russia, and Haggerty was quoted as saying, "Don't ask me, I'm not God." Somewhat out of proportion to the question. He said it as if the position were open. That's the part that, Thank you. Now Nixon's back in the picture, and he settles the steel strike, right? A couple of months ago, and he's a hero again. And he settled it by giving both sides a raise, which is novel. And he'd make a great marriage counselor, we felt at the time. Speaking of the steel strike, how about this? How about a Taft-Hartley injunction to force the president to stay in Washington for 80 days? That appeal to you? Thank you. Thank you, folks. Now you know where Richard Nixon came from. You know the derivation. the last thing I want to say before I go is communism is a world threat. Ever tell you about this? It's a true story. I was in Los Angeles, see? And I had gone to a movie with a girl, because I had nothing to say to her, so I went to the movies with her. Nothing to say to her. And she had nothing to say to me, you know. But we had a lot of chemistry. So, standard thing. So we went to see two movies, one of which was called The FBI Story. And it was pretty terrible, but all through it, J. Edgar Hoover kept saying, well, if you see anything wrong, call the FBI. That's your duty. People may call you melodramatic or a crank or, you know, a character or an alarmist or a stool pigeon, depending on their degree of dedication. But call the office. So I didn't think anything about it. You know, it was back here. You know, call the office. I got a blueprint for living, but I threw it away. So, I like the way I talk. It's nice, so I'm warm. So then I'm downtown looking for a Christmas present for this chick, see? And I'm going down to a discount house. I really want to go all out with this girl and get her something warm, something large, lugubrious, a blender. So I'm driving downtown. I'm driving by the auditorium. It's rented out to different people on different nights, like they have the Townsend Plan and Victor Lindelauer with health foods and all that. And one night there was a kid there, a debut on a violin. His mother papered the house, you know, that kind of stuff. And then at the bottom, it says, you ready now? This is great. It says, 40th anniversary of the Communist Party in America. You know, I thought they were outlawed. So I thought to myself, wow, you know, and then to make sure, because I don't want to be, you know, I want to be on firm ground on my accusations, I drove around the block and looked at it again. There's that sign of a big eagle. It says 40th anniversary. I decided, like the FBI story, I'm going to call the FBI, but I want to get all the information like they did in the picture, see? So I waited until the night that the Communist Party met in this auditorium, and I, like, just like in the picture, I rented an apartment across the street, see? And I got some binoculars up there, put another name in a mailbox, scotch tape, went upstairs, and I'm watching them over there, and I'm making notes, you know, mostly older people going in, no teenagers, I think it's a good sign, and making notes of mostly older people walking in with guitars in this meeting, and, you know, so once I got my information, I went downstairs to use the phone, because there's no phones in this place, and I went downstairs to the landlady and asked her if I could use the phone, and she said no. So I told her I thought she was a commie too, because I was really getting the fever. And so she let me use the phone because she didn't want to be mixed up with them. They'd rather be mixed up with me. That's the choice. And I called up and I called the FBI and I asked for the listing, you know, and this girl said, you know, in what city and all. And I said, you know, Los Angeles, FBI. I said, okay. So then it rang and this guy picks up the phone and he says, Agent Lane here, which is kind of, you know, it's a kind of English style. A lot of those guys went to Eastern schools, you know, and that's the way they learn to talk. So I said, listen, Agent Lane, you don't know me. I felt close to him, you know, that's why I said that. And I teed on movies, you can see my background. I said, you don't know me, but the Communist Party is meeting right now at the auditorium. So this is the funny part. It was kind of very cool and kind of a silence. And he says to me, what else do you think we should know? Well, I said, listen, I've been watching them, and there's mostly older people going in, and I says here in my notes. So he said, then why don't you let geriatrics take care of the threat? Little strong. So I said, listen, I don't want to alarm you, you know, but this is not a jazz concert, you know, this is it. So he said to me, well, I have respect for them. So I said, what does that mean? He says, it means that they're out in the open with their beliefs, but I wonder what axe you have to grind. So I said, like what? He says, well, you're implying that we're not doing our job. So I said, all right, since I'm across the street, why don't you pick me up after you get them? So he says, why don't you go home and take a cold shower, fella? So I said, no, I'm sorry I bothered you. You know, why don't you go home? And go home and take the day off. I know you were shook by this. Go home early and play with the kids, watch a little TV and go to bed early. You know, cool it. Try to forget. And when you wake up in the morning, the flag may have changed, but... You know. So I go home, see? And like 48 hours later, there's a special delivery and there's a kid standing out there with a pencil in his head, you know? And he's got... says, this is, you got to sign for this. It's a book from the FBI. It says, Crime in America, Statistics 1959, and a page is folded over there from this guy, and he says, I thought this might help you. And on it, it tells how many people are in the Communist Party in America, and says that there are less than 400, you know, communists in America, and that half of them are FBI agents, as I've pointed out earlier. Right? Interesting, huh? They're going to be betraying each other at the meetings. Right? So I kept the book. I keep in the kitchen along with airline schedules. And I keep all that stuff because sometimes you have nothing to read when you eat. You know that? And you get, you know, like on Sunday, and a maid comes by Saturday and throws everything out, and you don't have anything to read, and you're down there to where you're, you know, when you really get hard up, you don't want to look at the food. So you're hard up, and you're reading the instructions that came with the iron, right? The warranty with the radio, right? Pretty interesting. Although cordless, if dropped on the impact case. Well. Okay, now, are there any groups I haven't offended, he said? Thank you. I duck talking to you, and I want to say that I'm going to be on television June 7th, for those of you who don't see motion pictures, and or don't come back here. I'll be on television June 7th, on the June 6th, that's D-Day, right? On the Steve Allen Show. That's the last show of the season, and he was caught trying to save the world, Steve Allen. And I'm going to be on the show. It's going to be interesting, and it's fun. It's a very high morale program. I want to mention that. And I'm only on for car manufacturers, as you know. I was on for Pontiac earlier this year. I have some bounty from that show. It's in front of the club. They gave me a car. First American car I ever had. And thank you. And I must admit, though, I don't want to alienate you, sir, but American cars are not the kick that sports cars are, as I pointed out. I kind of dig them. There's, you know, certain surges I've pointed out in shifting gears and watching a tachometer and elliptical suspension, all those things. Because after all, how else are you going to get sexual satisfaction? Right, audience? Right? So, anyway, they're the car's upstairs. Now, I really want to thank you all for individual perception and urge you to join arms and sing labor songs. And if things go well, next year we won't have to hold these meetings in secret. I promise. And, listen. Did we really cover everything? I have to know here, because I thought it was, yeah, thank you. We have, geez, you know, it's always the same guy, you know, at least those rallies for Kennedy moves around the room, you know. What's on your mind there? Yeah, where? Whereabouts? Yeah, but I mean, where in Europe? I know they're there. Where in Europe? Bisonia. I'll tell you something about Europe. I might as well close with that. You remember an article in the Police Gazette that used to appear every month called Hitler is Alive? Remember that? Remember those articles? And it would always tell how some students who were on their summer vacation had gone to the art fair in Greenwich Village and had run into Hitler there. Who was trying to rehabilitate himself and paint and all. And they thought he was a good guy, and then it would always state that these students are not status-ridden, you know, and they wouldn't be impressed with someone just because he was Hitler, right? So much as the fact that he was from Europe. No. So, all right. Don't forget to save the cable cars. I want to congratulate you on your attention span. And I'm trying to think, what was the last thing I was going to tell you about Marin? Something happened, though. Oh, they're building a bowling alley in a new student union at Cal. That's depressing. And, you know, you think it's for recreation, but it's probably going to be a major. That's what I was kind of, right? Anyway, I now encourage you to break off into buzz groups and discuss the real meaning of the material, and we'll call it a day. Thank you. One and all. A few words about the U2. I think I can explain this move in foreign policies. So, as you know, the only way I can do this is to reconstruct it torturously. So bear with us, because it was kind of a torturous event. But espionage is never fun. So, anyway, the CIA sent the plane over. CIA is engaged in other things. For instance, recently when the kids rioted, the college kids, against the police in San Francisco, there were CIA agents with the kids wearing sweaters and beards. And then they... You suppose the police hit them, and then later they'd meet the police, say, I hated to do that, Colonel, but I had to convince the other students. You know? Good work, Sergeant. And one other thing. Remember that script? School spirit. Ah. Well, see, this plane was shot down on the 1st of May. On the 1st of May, it is moving. Anyway, we had this plane over there, I gather, to stop a sneak attack. Well, we want to know what they were going to do before the summit. What they were doing was sending a you know, that rocket ship to the moon. We missed that because we were looking at the other things. Anyway, we flew in, and the headlines burst upon us and said that a plane had been shot down over Russia. And the president wanted to say nothing until all the facts were brought to him and he could study them and confer with his associates and weigh all the values involved and then deny it. Then Khrushchev, in an effort to get Eisenhower off the hook, said, well, the president's a peace-loving man, and I'm sure he knew nothing about this flight. So now the administration figures, well, there's nothing going on the president doesn't really know about. So as a basic premise with the people, so they said, the president didn't know about the flight, and the president assured us that he knew about that flight and all the other flights over Russia. Now, the crowded sky. They don't even let jets over their cities, you know, their own, but that's all. So, how do you know that? Just a guidebook, no more. Well, how do you feel about them? Curious. So, I admire their art, with the exception of the cranes are flying. You see? Awful. So, except a lot of liberal girls went and said, yes, but look at the planes in her face and all that. But it was awful. So, very heavy-handed. So, anyway, excuse me for digressing. Now, now it's all coming out, the plane went. So the State Department is trying to cool it, see? And they said, well, the plane was shot down 1,300 miles within the border of Russia, so obviously we've got a plane that could penetrate their radar defense, which, you know, felt pretty good. But, well, we have, huh? And I felt better about it. Except the question is, if we have that plane, how did the Russians sight the U-2? Well, many rumors. One is that they looked down and there it was coming in. And then, right, so now they screened these guys. You know, they had to screen the spies and they had to get a guy who was ready to destroy himself. That's part of being a spy. So they ask a lot of indirect questions here. You know, like, are you a supporter of Senator Kennedy? See if there are any conflicts. And that doesn't, a lot of people who are not supporters of Senator Kennedy are not necessarily willing to destroy themselves to prove it. But anyway, so now they get this, see, so they got powers. Now, they're going to try them, you know, but they'll let them go because in France and Italy, all this, in the European countries, it'll go over big that they don't have punishment. That's a good propaganda weapon because they hate us over there for having capital punishment. And as you know, there's a big scuffle going on in this state now about capital punishment. Largely, oddly enough, the religious groups want capital punishment, believing you must pay for the error of your ways, even if a man is occasionally executed unjustly. And they believe in that, even though they made a very large mistake once. But that's it. You, sure! Now, so, Powers is off, and he's got the bomb under his seat, the ejection seat, and he's got a poison needle. And he's to use those. Those are the alternatives. And then the Russians caught him in a searchlight and start shooting at him. And he chose a third alternative, I gather. He chose communism at that point, right? It's a fine. There's nobody you can trust anymore. That's the problem. Right? Talking about domestic health. You only get a girl who can come in. Think big. So he's in Russia now, and the State Department issues another statement, and then the president said, well, what are they so self-righteous about? You know, they've got spies in our country, too, which is true. There are Russian spies here now, and I think if we're lucky, maybe they'll steal some of our secrets, and then they'll be 2 years behind, and that'll... Well, now, what's happening to the national morality? We've had two spies in our history. Nathan Hale, who said, I regret that I have but one life to give for my country, and Francis Powers is quoted as saying, this shatters all my plans. It's depressing. So now, let's see, where does that take us? Oh, now we have surplus U-2s. See, because the president suspended the flights. So they were purchased by an entrepreneur, and you'll be hearing more about that later, probably in one form or another. Maybe you'll be walking around Los Angeles and these leaflets will drop down from the sky and they'll say, your picture has just been taken and is available for 25 cents. Well, I think, you know what really saved the day then? Then Captain Beach arrived in the Triton. He'd been underwater for 83 days. And he came up and that took our minds off the U-2. And President Eisenhower gave Captain Beach a medal for being one of the few officers whose whereabouts he knows. And then nobody knew what to say. It's like, one of our aircraft are missing, and one of our presidents, in the opinion of many. Now, we're off to the summit. Go to the summit, and they arrive at the summit, and Khrushchev walks in. And Khrushchev, of course, held a press conference in which he said a lot of things which aroused the world. He insulted the Germans. He can't seem to forget. And he'd make a good movie producer. Those are the kind of pictures, right? So they keep making them. And then after that, he insulted the president, and he said, "I demand an apology." The president said no. So then Khrushchev canceled his trip to Russia. So I don't want to humiliate anybody, but I was thinking I'd be willing to apologize to Khrushchev if I thought it would get the president back on his trip to Russia, because I think it'd be good. You know? Hoping, of course, he would announce the flight in advance, because they're sensitive in those areas. Now he's into, it's very exciting. Then Khrushchev said, "I don't want to deal with you. You won't be in office in 6 months," which was a good opportunity for Eisenhower to say, "What are your plans, by the way?" See, quite a mortality rate on red executives. And then after that, Khrushchev went home, and the president made a tour of cathedrals in France to relax before he came home. And going through the ruins, archaeology is a good subject with the prospect before us these days. And then he's off. So, and it didn't look too good. Then the president came home, and Adlai Stevenson characterized his work as a blunder, which many of the newspapers found uncharitable on Stevenson's part. After all, the man does have a gift for language, and that's an awkward way to sum up. So, unless he felt that way. So then he, and then of course Khrushchev went to East Berlin and modified it, and he said, "There will be no war for 6 to 8 months. RSVP. Listen, wouldn't you like to get up once in the morning and see a proposal by our side? It's really driving me crazy. No initiative. It says, Khrushchev says go to the summit, Khrushchev says go home, Khrushchev says and he attacks the president, and Khrushchev says disarm, and that really bugs me, you know, because I see the administration in a very passive role. In fact, it's almost a female role. I have a vision of them in Washington. Did he call today? Why doesn't he call? The Guantanamo Naval Base, Castro's been cutting them off day by day, and the American papers are pretty, scorched about it. And he's been, first of all, he wouldn't let the water supply in, according to them. Then he tried to organize the 3,000 Cuban laborers there, and it said the admiral in charge of Guantanamo was quoted in the paper today as saying, "It's pretty grim that our men have to mow their own lawns now. They can't hire Cuban help. And and the women have to, do the kitchen work themselves and all." But he said it might be good for them for a while. You know, it's kind of a change of pace. And this is kind of interesting. And then it said, Castro has closed down these houses of ill fame which ring the naval base there. So I knew eventually Castro would go too far. That's what I was coming to. Right? That's right. No man is that big, right? Power-hungry dictator. So he has no sense of reality, Castro, according to our papers. He also wouldn't allow any girls up in the hills when the rebels were in the hills. You had to marry any chick you were with. Pretty moral, huh? So now, so much for that. Now back to our theme, which is what? Oh, the other thing is De Gaulle. I want to mention that. De Gaulle was here, and a lot of people cheered him. A lot of kids I saw were yelling. Some kids from Lowell High School yelling for De Gaulle and all. And I never knew why, because they don't even know where he was during the war, because they're all like 12, those kind of people, and they don't remember Truman and all that, So they don't know, but it shows how hard up we are for a hero. I think that's, the point, You'll be fine. Don't change a thing, So he's here, and he was here, and then he rode around. They took him through the financial district, and he drove around Montgomery Street there, where all these people are walking up and down, going to the office with man tan on. And, right? That's what do you think about man tan? I'm philosophically opposed to it. I know, because if you can't believe in the sun, what can you believe in? I know. Thank you. Thank you for the sun. I came to help you carry the sun, Orpheus, right? Well, okay. Now, the only other point is, what's our other premise? Oh, de Gaulle. So de Gaulle was taken to the financial district, and there's a picture of Nixon talking to him in Washington and telling him that they're going to drop paper on him. That's what they do in a financial district. When they're not jumping themselves, he should have said. But anyway. Now, I have a few words about the American Medical Association. As I understand it, President Eisenhower was asked to address them. And he addressed them in Atlantic City, where people are pushed along in those chairs by members of minority groups who should push them off the pier and thereby practice eugenics. Anyway, this doctor, these doctors, there's about 4,000 of them, no women or anything, really footloose and fancy free. So President Eisenhower spoke to them and he said, "We socialized medicine is in Canada, but it shouldn't be here." And the doctors dug that. I'd say that's reaching your audience pretty well. They'll said, "Hey, wonderful, more of that." And then the president said, "Canada's much too close, and as far as I'm concerned, socialized medicine, you know, the doctors were paid by the government, it would destroy their incentive, and hospital facilities would be chaos." And of course, this bitterness on the part of the president has its origin in the bad treatment he's received at government hospitals, as you know, right? He's now 69 years of age and never bought a bottle of aspirin. So now, by now the doctors really dig this, and because it's a convention, a lot of them have seltzer bottles and electric canes. And, and he said, "They better not try to bring socialized medicine around during my regime," and a lot of doctors were forming conga lines and everything. And they were cheering and carrying him around on their shoulders and saying, "This guy's great. Let's have him back again next year." What's his name? Something to think about. Hey, it's time for summer stuff. A lot of wonderful plays are going to be done. Thought-provoking theater, like Time Out for Ginger. It's kind of plays that fit to the worst plays in the world. And low-budget plays, where people walk to a window. Let's do Graham Greene. Walk to a window and have black tar paper over it. The guy looks at the tar paper and says, "Ah, Africa." You know those kind of plays? All open with a maid dusting to set the scene. Well, boy. Now, are there any groups I haven't offended? Good. I feel pretty good. Everything was good. On the next show at 1 o'clock, I'm going to talk about chicks in grim detail. I'm going to destroy women. There's nothing left. And that's something to do at that time, which should be exciting. Try and be here if you can. And there'll be a lot of kids in white coats here, so think of yourself as a faculty chaperone. Hey, did I tell you about the joke at the University of Miami? They're 90 miles from Florida, you know. So, I mean, this is a Freudian slip. They're 90 miles from... Go there. They're 90 miles from Cuba. So, you're anticipating, Raul. They're 90 miles from Cuba, and everybody's nervous at the university. The faculty, you know, not the kids. The kids don't care about anything. They're all, you ever see that school? They all walk around, with tennis rackets and bowling balls and golf clubs. Those who have majors. Where's the others? It's the girls in a lab with the white mice. Wonderful. So no makeup in a lab class in the morning because you're serious, right? Very good. So I took a life today. I killed a frog in class. Come on, let's get some coffee and forget it. How's it going with you? Well, it's too late to study this semester. I'll study next semester. I'm going to keep good notes. I'm going to write them. Then I'm going to copy them on a typewriter in red ink. Then once a week, I'm going to copy them in black ink. And once a month, I'm going to get these stone tablets and hack them in. Listen, before I forget, before I go, I want to mention, I have a movie coming out. And it's called All the Young Men. I hope you see it. It's out in August, and I think. And it's about the Korean War. And it's cast the way movies are cast today. It's amazing. There's hardly any women working in pictures. Remember? Stars? That has to do with, you know how they ever always told you America was a matriarchy? It isn't. These chicks try to be actresses till they're like 30, then they quit and marry an actor and express themselves through charity, you know, the League for Retired Movie Horses and all that. No, I think that's wrong, but that's all right. How about this? A woman's place is in the stove, right? Or, the trouble with Madame Curie is she was too competitive, right? That's a good one. Or, you know, there's a lot of jokes that are anti-male that don't get any reaction in this club. For instance, why do you drive sports cars? How else are you going to get sexual satisfaction? So, anyway, but here's the way they cast the movie today. This picture stars Alan Ladd. So you get a male star, that's how you get your money from the bank. Sidney Poitier is in it, plays a platoon sergeant in the picture. He's in there because you gotta have respectability, a Broadway actor. Then you have James Darren, Teenagers, as a title song. And then Ingemar Johansson is in it for the audience, which must be subpoenaed. And I'm in it, and my appeal is somewhat indeterminate at this point. It's those people who chase Sigmund Rhee with rocks, right? Hey, he's here. He's here. Did you see that? It was on the news last night. He came in from Honolulu. And good guy. You know, they gave him some lays in Honolulu, and a lot of people dug him. It's a big country. There's people that dig everything. And it's great. He wouldn't let anybody carry his bags. He's kind of democratic. And he wouldn't let anybody touch them, as a matter of fact. Swiss bank books. He just dropped in to have a few suits made, and so Eisenhower will give him a medal. Watch. Can find work for him. Easier to place than Harold Stassen, right? All right. Anyway, those of you who have applauded have signified yourselves as group leaders. And as I leave, I'd like you to act as a rallying point for collective action. And we'll say goodnight. Thank you very much.